This video, I'd be making a homemade antibiotic called sulfanilamide in my shed. That's right boys, I first teased this video like 8 months ago and it took me this long to finish this. So the reason why I'm making this video is because for over a year, I was convinced that it was possible to make sulfanilamide from simple chemicals which you can buy online or find at a hardware store if you're lucky. Now, even though it is possible, I've had no idea how hard and life-threatening this procedure would actually be. Anyway, let's get to the chemistry stuff. Even though this procedure is quite complicated, the start is pretty simple, as it begins with the production of oleum, which in simple terms is basically fuming sulfuric acid. And it's more corrosive, more powerful and more dangerous than regular oil concentrated sulfuric acid. So to a boiling flask, I've added around 15 grams of a potent dehydrating agent called phosphorus pentoxide. Then I've assembled a distillation apparatus. Finally, I've added some corrosive sulfuric acid into the flask, and as you can see, a white mist of cancer vapors being produced. And that's our sulfur trioxide. At first, I thought the reaction would take off immediately, but I guess we need to give it a little push by heating it up. As the reaction goes on, the sulfuric acid in the condenser gets this blackish tint, which means it has picked up some sulfur trioxide. So after around an hour, I felt that the reaction was finally finished. So I've tilted the condenser so that the oleum could flow all the way into the receiving flask. After all that, I've moved the oleum into a volumetric flask for storage.
Anyway,
we're now ready to convert the oleum into chlorosulfonic acid. But first, what even is chlorosulfonic acid? Well, some could say it's a really quirky chemical, because it's classified as a super acid. To show you just how unreal it is, here's a clip from Advanced Tinkering, which dissolved a fruit in it. And you can see just how aggressive it is. Anyway, to make our super acid, I've transferred the oleum into that same boiling flask which we've used earlier. Then I fitted it with a condenser. Then I set up a quick HCl gas generator with a moisture scrubber. And finally, I've put the output of the gas generator directly into the oleum. This reaction has to be done in anhydrous conditions, aka there can be no water present whatsoever, or we will lose yield. That's why in this boiling flask there's a bunch of desiccant which will dry the HCl gas. The HCl gas was generated from a mixture of table salt and sulfuric acid. You can see the anhydrous HCl bubbles going through the oleum, and once there's a thick mist of hydrochloric acid at the top, that means that the HCl is no longer absorbed by the oleum, which means that the reaction is mostly complete. Then, after that was done, I've distilled the newly made superacid. This distillation was really easy to carry out, since the acid itself has a relatively low boiling point. And finally, I bottled it, and absolutely no disaster happened here. Anyway, now that we've got around 2 mL of chlorosulfonic acid, which was apparently discolored due to using plastic pipettes, we can now begin the second step of this procedure. So, to a round bottom flask, which was stuffed in an ice bath, I added some acetonide, which I've bought online. Then I've added all the chlorosulfonic acid into it. Initially, an exothermic reaction can be observed, however after a while all of that subsides, and the mixture has to be stirred. Eventually, the whole thing turns into this oily goop, which makes it impossible to stir with a stir bar. Next, to complete the reaction, we'll be heating the whole thing at around 80°C. This reaction is more complicated than it looks. First, the chlorosulfonic acid does a regular sulfonation of the acetonide, which produces a sulfonic acid functional group at the para position. This then reacts with excess chlorosulfonic acid to turn the sulfonic acid group into the chlorosulfonic acid functional group. In organic chemistry, chlorine is very easily replaced by other groups, and we'll be taking advantage of that property by replacing it with an amide group. And we'll be doing that in the next step. First, however, let's precipitate our product by dumping it into ice cold water. Next, I've done a vacuum filtration, and here's some of our product. Then I've collected everything in a beaker, and then I've added some concentrated ammonia solution. Besides the fact that ammonia smells like piss, it's a very useful reagent. Here, we are using ammonia to replace this chlorine atom with an amide group. With the chlorine replaced, we've essentially just formed the sulfonamide functional group, which is what makes the magic happen. Now to get sulfanilamide, all you have to do is just get rid of this acetyl group which is connected to the nitrogen. However, first let me address why are we even using acetonide. I mean, if you were to use aniline, the chlorosulfonic group would just attach itself to the same place, right? Not really. If we were to just use aniline and chlorosulfonate that, there could be many side reactions which could happen. That would not only decrease our yield, but also give us other cool stuff like tar. This hydrogen is the most reactive in the whole aniline molecule, and by attaching an acetyl group onto it, we're essentially giving this nitrogen a shield, and will discourage the chlorosulfonic acid from attacking this nitrogen. But now that it has served its purpose, it's time to throw it out. To do that, all I've had to do was crystallize our product, and also as a side note, I've caught it in the middle of crystallizing and these needle-like crystals are absolutely freaking gorgeous. Anyway, then we take all the precipitate, filter it, and then wash it with some concentrated hydrochloric acid. And then we heat it in a reflux. Here, by using a strong acid, we're hydrolyzing the acetyl group, which liberates it from the compound, in the form of acetic acid, aka vinegar. Then, after it's done cooking, let's neutralize this acidic solution with some sodium carbonate. Then I've put it into a fridge to crystallize and boom, here we go. Here's our antibiotic precipitate, and I've gotta tell you, it's an extremely shitty yield, to be honest. I filtered it and there was barely any on the papers, so I must have done something wrong along the way. Well, that's life and that's organic chemistry, so I'm not really going to dwell on it for too long. Still though, it was a really fun prep, so thanks for watching.